I'm Jacob from the Cedar Pacific Library, and today we're going to be playing with bismuth. Now, you may be asking yourself, what is bismuth? Bismuth is a brittle, crystalline white metal with an iridescent shimmer and is element 83 on the periodic table. It is also a post-transitional metal, probably. It honestly depends who you ask. But to explain it rather briefly, transition metals include things like copper, lead, gold, etc., all of which are known for their high melting points, boiling points, and just general conductivity. Post-transition metals, however, share some of these characteristics, but are often softer and conduct more poorly. In fact, bismuth's electrical and thermal conductivity is unusually low for a metal. It also has a particularly low melting point at just 521 degrees Fahrenheit. So, as a layman, yeah, post-transitional metal sounds about right. Bismuth has a variety of uses, including cosmetics, alloys, and even fire extinguishers. It is probably best known as the main ingredient in stomach ache remedies such as Pepto-Bismol, I guess because Pepto-Bismuth sounded too much like science and not enough like marketing. First things first, for getting our bismuth experiment going, we are going to start our melting process. In order to avoid burning myself and possibly my home down, I'll be doing this outside using a camp stove and the requisite safety equipment. As our bismuth slowly starts to melt, you'll notice more and more of its unusually beautiful coloring start to appear. This coloring is from a thin film of bismuth oxide that forms as the molten metal is exposed to air. The coloring is a result of something known as thin film interference, a natural phenomenon where light waves bounce off bismuth oxide and oxide air. How these light waves color our various oxides depends largely on three factors: the wavelength and angle of the light that hits it, and the thickness of the film on the object's surface. Collectively, all of these things change how the surface color will appear initially, as well as how much it will change based on the angle we view it from. If that sounded sort of confusing, that's probably because I didn't explain it very well. Yeah, I tried. But in essence, the hard science looks like this. But in practicality, things look like this, this, and ideally, this. Now that our bismuth is fully melted, you'll notice this gray matter sort of sitting on top here. This is what is known as slag, which are natural impurities in the bismuth that need to be removed to make it as pure as possible. A little is okay, but it's important to remove as much as you can. With that being taken care of, it might actually be time to talk about what we're going to attempt to accomplish today. We've discussed how bismuth melts extremely easily for a metal, and how when it's exposed to oxides when it's molten, it creates a wonderful array of colors. However, another interesting thing to know is that as it cools down, highly pure bismuth can form into stepped pyramids and other interesting and strange forms. This type of crystal is known as a hopper. The hopper crystal forms because as it cools, bismuth is strongly driven to rapidly form hard edges in preparation for making a cube-shaped crystal, which is the natural shape that bismuth atoms make as they stack on top of each other. With enough time and a slow enough decrease in temperature, we should see these atoms naturally want to bond to each other and naturally create these highly detailed crystals. My first thought was to simply set the camp stove at its lowest setting and let the temperature drop from there. Unfortunately, even at its lowest setting, the camp stove was running too hot for much, if any, crystallization to actually start happening. Next, we tried letting the bismuth cool naturally, and even letting it cool to the side of the heat source. Both of these unfortunately led to the bismuth cooling so quickly that what few crystals we did get were rather small. So, we need to find something that will retain the heat of our molten bismuth so it can give our crystals more time to grow. For this, I settled on using a large steel bowl filled with sand, mainly because I remember how much heat my sandbox stored in those summers growing up. While reheating our bismuth, I'm going to add a few more of our metal pieces to give our crystals the most depth to grow, while also remembering to remove any slag that flows to the surface. Once that is done, we're going to move our pan and place it as neatly as possible into the pan-shaped divot in our sand. Judging from the larger size of the clusters we pull from our bismuth, it seems to work much better than simply letting it cool naturally. The question is, can we do better? If we were to add a layer of aluminum foil, would the pan retain a greater amount of heat? Well, after reheating the metal and adding the remains of our bismuth, the answer is no. No, not really. Maybe with another 10, 20 more layers of aluminum foil, we could see a greater amount of retained heat, but a single layer did little, if anything, to actually increase our formation times. But we did manage to create a few more decently sized crystals, which is nice. Now, there is one more question lingering in my mind. We used sand in order to act as a retainer for our bismuth's heat. Sand consists largely of fine rock and mineral particles. It is nearly impossible to tell what exactly is in our sand, but it's largely made out of things like silicon dioxide, in the form of quartz, and that has a melting point of just above 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, there are a myriad of reactions organic compounds can have outside of melting, and so it begged the question, was there anything in our sand that would react to our liquid bismuth? And if so, what would that look like? And most importantly,
Why was I just asking myself these questions instead of actually finding out the answers? With only 20 pounds of molten metal and a dream, I carefully walk over to our sand and pour out a portion of our bismuth. Once again, I prove my impatience by waiting nowhere near long enough to see what sort of reaction we have achieved, causing what should have been a nice, simple disc shape to disintegrate into whatever this is. On the bright side, however, it did give us a wonderful contrast between the parts of the bismuth that touched the sand and the parts that didn't. As you can see, the parts that only interacted with the air carry the same iridescent markings of our regular bismuth, albeit mostly relegated to dark blues and purples. And as we rotate the bismuth, we can clearly see that it did in fact have a reaction with the sand. You'll notice the color is pretty much exclusively gold, so much so that it looks less like bismuth and more like fool's gold, aka pyrite. When I looked online to see why this reaction occurred, I could find no answers. Which I choose to believe means we are on the cutting edge of bismuth alloy technology. Now, despite this being the first time I've had to play with bismuth, the experiment still ended up creating several beautiful crystalline structures. What's more, you can actually see the small lines that trace across some of the squares, showing how the metal naturally wants to stack on top of itself. It makes me wonder what more time, patience, and propane would allow us to create. Thanks for watching, and if you'd like to see more videos from the Cedar Topic Library, check out our YouTube channel.